705 Sports with Jacob and Colette, Fridays at 4 p.m.
Hello, welcome to 705 Sports. You are with Jacob and Colette. We hope you had a great week. Unfortunately, we are not sporting our blue and white TML colors in a victorious celebration, but we will forever be sporting our blue and white
TML. And not burning any jerseys.
No, we're not going to burn any jerseys, which kind of ticks me off that that happened. And Doug Gilmour did take to Twitter and had a few things to say about that, but I don't want to give that any airtime, Jacob.
No.
I do not. What we do want to give airtime to is what's currently going on in the NHL. I would love to talk about the Boston Bruins at some point in this
We will be in the third segment.
Excellent.
It's almost like you have a script. You know what's in it.
I know. Whoa. It is. And might I add that even though I was crushed, demolished, spirits diminished, crying with the Toronto Maple Leafs, I am so happy that Boston is not continuing to the second round. Okay, what are we starting off with today?
So let's start off with, we talked about last week about what the Leafs did. Now let's talk about the Winnipeg Jets. We got to think about this. So the Winnipeg Jets sweep the Edmonton Oilers.
Yeah.
And you're thinking, everyone's like, oh, they're going to demolish Montreal.
Yeah.
Montreal just went, no.
Yeah.
I don't know how to say no in French. But they went, and then...
I'm pretty sure it's no.
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 They went and... frankly, demolished
yes.
the Jets.
Yeah.
So I have some key points onto why this happened.
Okay.
So the first one I want to get into is the suspension to Mark Scheifele.
Oh.
Now, before we get into that a lot, did you think 4 games was a little much?
It's not that I thought it was a little much. I thought that with the Kadri hit that we were talking about before, mm-hmm. they just didn't seem to, there was no comparison there. You know what I
yeah.
mean? Like, why did Kadri get this? Why? I don't know. I didn't see the hit. From what I understand, it was not done
maliciously.
Yeah,
no,
exactly.
It wasn't.
Exactly. I mean, we could talk about the hit that John Tavares hit had too. I mean, that wasn't unintentional.
That's another one, but there is a little more to
I'm
that one.
I'm just kidding
but
about
I mean,
that. I'm just bitter.
But I do feel with that one, the team never recovered from the Mark Scheifele incident, which also, if you watched the show last week, I thought it should have been a 2-game suspension, not a 4. I felt 4 was a little much for a first-time offender in the playoffs. But also, too, when Scheifele was out and Stastny was injured, the depth at the center wasn't there. And I know Mark Scheifele personally. Like, we're not, like, buddies or anything. We're not homies. But, like, he played for the Barry Colts, and he was on our show a lot. And he is someone who has that competitive edge. And the team seemed to lose that edge. And you can tell he has an edge because he even told reporters how they lost the series when he was essentially taken out of the series because nobody wants to see Winnipeg win just Montreal and Toronto.
Right.
So he took a bit of a shot at the NHL there, which we'll see if he ends up getting fined for that or not.
Okay.
The NHL seems to like to fine NHL people for freedom of speech this year, so I could see him getting fined for that. But they really lost their edge when Scheifele was out.
Okay.
Like 100%. He's their best player skill-wise. Yeah. And then going into my next point, a player who didn't step up, Pierre-Luc Dubois.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, they traded Patrick Laine for Dubois.
Okay.
And Dubois just... didn't do it. Dubois was do not.
Dubois was do what?
He just wasn't there. 3 points in 7 games. No points
yeah.
against Montreal. He looked lazy. He wasn't back checking. It was just a cluster of mistakes. And a lot of people thought John Tortorella was the problem with Pierre-Luc Dubois. I think now we're seeing Pierre-Luc Dubois as the problem with Pierre-Luc Dubois. Because I think Paul Maurice is a great coach.
Yes,
and players want to play for him.
Yeah.
They do.
Yeah.
We have both said how we wish Toronto never got rid of Maurice.
Yeah, him and Connor Brown.
Yeah. Who
don't get me
did a great job for Team Canada.
He absolutely did. And I am not surprised.
Neither am I. It was that Connor Brown and Nick Paul pairing again
yeah,
that got the game-winning goal. But
absolutely.
I would say if I'm Winnipeg right now, I'm sitting in Winnipeg's chair with Shovel Day off, love that name.
Uh-huh.
I say get Luc Dubois out of there. I think, admit the Laine trade was a disaster, because it was an absolute disaster.
Okay.
Laine's going to light up the lamp in Columbus, but I think you need to trade him.
Okay. Where else are we going with this? Should we talk a bit about Montreal and the next steps for Montreal? Where's that?
I would say for Montreal, for what they've done right, Carey Price looked really solid yet again.
Let's just stop and just pause for the cause. And again, as a Leaf fan, you want to see Price putting on that jersey. It's never going to happen. But no. I absolutely love Carey Price. And, you know, like I said to my Montreal lovers, when they said, oh, Montreal won again, I said, listen, if Montreal's beating my team, they better be hoisting that Stanley Cup.
Which, you know what, people may think I'm nuts, but I think this year especially we're seeing depth is beating star power. And what Montreal also has, besides Carey Price, with Carey Price, a 197 goals against average,
crazy.
A 935 save percentage,
so
plus a shutout. He's been playing outstanding. But another big, big point, which is, this is one of your points that you brought up going into the first series against Toronto, their fourth line led by Eric Staal.
Yeah.
Eric Staal did nothing in the season. Now in the playoffs, he has 7 points.
Yeah, well, maybe he can teach a few of our Toronto Maple Leafs what to do when they get to the playoffs. Eminem. We know who you are.
Eric Staal has been an absolute beast. Corey Perry as well with 6 points. And Joel Armeri with 7 points. Okay. And that fourth line has been literally winning them games.
Yeah, they're excellent. They're an excellent team. And I wish them well. I mean, they've got some
they got depth.
Stiff competition coming up, though.
They do, because they're either going to be facing either Colorado or
Vegas. Yep.
Which we'll break the rules here a little bit. We're recording this on Thursday due to some situations with just staff.
Oh yeah,
but
sorry.
We know that we'll either
be facing.
Let
the cat out of the bag on that one, didn't I? Wow. I watched the news in the morning show. Saw, hey, Colette wore that outfit. She wore it again. She didn't. No, she does not.
She doesn't wear vests though. So like.
Yes. So I do stress.
Exactly. But I do think what Montreal is also doing really well, their depth, they're clogging the center, especially against Toronto and against Winnipeg as well. You could see it. Teams are getting just frustrated.
Yeah.
They cannot get anything through that neutral zone, which is essentially making it where Montreal can control the entire game. And they're also being led by some of their young stars. Cole Caulfield, 4 assists, who didn't even start the series, which I remember saying, what are you doing, Ducharme?
Yeah.
I guess he hacked into Sheldon Keefe's bugs, so he knew what to do by listing the 705 sports of Jacob and Colette.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, we do need to talk about how I was accurate on a few first-round predictions.
Were.
Stay tuned.
But also to Kotkaniemi, 4 goals, playing fantastic.
Yeah.
He's been a big playoff performer. And one of my favorite players, Nick Suzuki, with 8 points.
Oh, he's awesome.
He is. I would trade pretty much anybody besides like Jake Muzzin and Morgan Riley.
Yeah, you're not talking
to
Muzzin.
A guy like Nick Suzuki on my team. He's 21 with this playoff prowess.
Yeah.
Like, this kid
crazy,
has it.
Crazy,
and,
good.
And he's working on shutting down some big names. Same with Philip Deneau. And another big thing for the Montreal Canadiens.
Montreal.
Would totally be
Montreal.
their top four defense. You look at Weber, Petrie, Sherratt, and Edmondson. That's a big defense, and it's more of an old school defense.
Yeah.
Like, they are big, they're strong. You are afraid to go into the zone. Mind you, Sherratt's a little bit dirty at times. Mm-hmm. Like, I find Petrie and Weber play hard. I find Sherratt plays a little dirty. To get into the Tavares hit, just a smidge. Not bitter, I swear. But if you actually look, it wasn't Corey Perry that did the most damage. It was Sherratt extending his leg to knee Tavares, and that's why Tavares was out, was the knee, not the concussion.
Right.
So it's one of those things, right? Like, Sherratt, he is a good defenseman nonetheless, but their top four defense is absolutely key, and we've seen it against Winnipeg and Toronto. Like, for Winnipeg, they never had a lead in that series, Winnipeg. They never led, not even like, they never mind winning a game. They never had a lead.
Yeah.
Montreal, and since game five, has not given up a lead yet. Since game five against Toronto. Like, you have to give that team credit.
Awesome. I agree with you. I absolutely agree with you. We also have to give credit to some local sports heroes, which we're going to come up talk about in the second segment. We've got another gold medal Olympian, or gold medal hockey player, who used to play for the Soo Thunderbirds. And did you know that the Greyhounds had their OHL draft and they picked a few? And on top of that, how about this Taya Curry, first female in the OHL?
We're such an awesome story.
I know. We've got all that coming up. If you stay tuned, we'll be right back with more sports with Jacob and Colette.
705 Sports, supported by Gary Chervinsky, Exit Realty, Lake Superior. Buying a home is a big decision, so is choosing the right agent. Call Gary Chervinsky, broker at Exit Realty, Lake Superior, 705-257-5432.
Welcome back to 705 Sports with Jacob and Colette. I realized something.
What?
I haven't said...
Eggs.
Eggs.
I knew you were going to say
eggs.
That.
Because I realized, I didn't say it last week either.
I don't think anybody so knows like, what it means, but I think that's what you know keeps what? You intrigued. Is eggs, that why you keep coming back to watch us? Eggs?
Eggs is a state of mind, okay?
It is a state of mind.
It is a feeling. It is constant healing and it's revealing. Just like a banana, it's appealing.
What would we do without our in-house wrapper?
Be
well,
bored?
Let me ask you this question. What would we do without our local talent? Because I'm telling you, this city produces great athletes.
They really do.
Specifically, let's talk hockey. What else is new? We do want to dive into a little bit against... You know what? I'm going to open up with Taya Curry first. Let's start there. Because what we had... obviously, we're super excited for Taya. She was drafted in this last draft, but and being the first female... raises questions, concerns as to why there isn't a professional hockey league out there for women. Do we have enough women in this country who are exceptional hockey players? 100% yes, because I'll tell you right here in Sault Ste. Marie, we have the Wildcats who produce excellent female hockey players. My niece Brielle Caruso, she is off going to be playing for the Guelph Griffins in Guelph next year.
That's a cool name.
Yes, but this last year she was in London playing hockey out there because that's where the league was. So what about our Northern Ontario women who are outstanding? If you ever get a chance to go watch a Wildcats game coming up, please do. They're seriously entertaining. But we just wanted to highlight the Taya Curry for making history and becoming the first female to be drafted to the OHL.
And something I wanted to bring up with that as well. So I was looking into this a little bit more. We have a professional women's league that's comparable to the NHL, but we don't have one that's comparable to the CHL.
Oh, yes.
Like, there is the college university route, obviously, and hey, that is great for people that fits their route. But what if that doesn't fit your route necessarily? I think if you want to promote the women's game, which I think 100% you should, like I've said during this multiple lockdowns. Yeah. I started watching women's hockey more and discovering I actually enjoy the game more than I thought. And I will admit that's something on my fault. I should have checked it out earlier. But it's one of these things, maybe if there was more competitive of the sport going through all the age groups and just, you know, push it more. And if you want to push the professional league, you need to give them more outlets for these players to develop. You look if you're, let's say I was a lot thinner, a lot more athletic and a bit younger than I could, actually quite a bit younger, not telling you my age, even though you might already know.
Yeah.
But I had so many outlets to play sports at a high competitive level.
Yes.
The women's game doesn't have that same pizzazz.
And that's indicative of all female sports.
I don't understand it.
Yeah, I have my background is soccer, and yes, we did have a lot of opportunities to go to American universities and with scholarships, but nothing in Canada. Now, where is the support from the Canadian government for female athletes or for any athletes at that? And that also comes down to another conversation I want to have one time about the Olympics and where Canada sits, typically where they fall in the Olympics. What's going on? You know, why are we falling short? Maybe we need to invest more money into our talent here in Canada.
Because we definitely do on the men's game.
Yeah.
But not so much in the women's game. And that's something that, honestly, as a sports fan and part of the sports community, it really bothers me.
Right. Now, what about if we go back and talk about the skills competition in the NHL? Mm-hmm. Had a pretty fast female skater there. Once
comparable to McDavid in the
absolutely.
Numbers.
Absolutely. McDavid, as you know, has wheels times 100 wheels.
Plus four. He must eat a lot of eggs.
Times two and not divided. okay, Ontario Hockey League had its 2021 U18 priority selection. And, well, the Greyhounds definitely picked up a few. It was the fifth year the league has held such an event to follow up on their traditional OHL priority selection. I do remember this with our own Jack Mateer when he was picked up
by the Ottawa.
That, you know, my son attended that priority status, that whole thing. And you wait for it to come up on the internet. Like the internet is like, you know, oh, pop up, pop up. And that started very early in the morning. And I do know there was a few wobbly pops by 10 a.m. that was down. So I assume that this year was no different for these other families. The 20-team event saw the Greyhounds make three selections. They are James Johnson, who's a right winger from the Whitby Wildcats. He went in round one. Colton Donaldson from the Burlington Eagles. Hello. I lived just above Burlington for years. Colton Donaldson from the Burlington Eagles is round two. And David Brands, a righty from the Don Mills Flyers U18, round three. Great selections. They are continually updating the Greyhound site with any details and information with regards to hockey and the next season. As Jack Mateer was saying, with his team in Ottawa, they did a lot of Zoom interviews, a lot of Zoom meetings. You know, just to stay engaged with the team.
Which is super important.
Absolutely. But I am hoping that these three wonderful new additions to the Soo Greyhounds will be able to lace up and skate at the GFL soon.
And just welcome them to Sault Ste. Marie in general. I mean, you're going to love it here. You're going to love, I don't know if they call us Hound Nation. I'm going to go with that, Hound Nation.
It's Hound a Pound. Very,
the Hound
the
Pound.
The Hound Pound, I like, believe.
That actually makes a lot more
yes,
sense.
Yes, it does.
It is a awesome atmosphere here. This town really supports its minor hockey. And I think people will find that coming from down south to up north. You're going to see that more like passion behind minor league sports. We're here versus down south because we don't have the big boys that close.
Well, what happens is when you're from southern Ontario, you
from
have
the sale.
From the sale down from the deep south. Have you ever seen Little Nicky? Yeah, I'm from the deep south.
I reckon.
We have the Buffalo Sabres. We have the Boom. Toronto Maple Leafs. Yeah. I'm just saying, we have our NHL players. The support that this community gives their Ontario, their OHL team.
Even the Thunderbirds too, though.
Like, oh my gosh! Support you get from that. And whoa, Kel Segway, Mister, because I want to hit the Soo Thunderbirds right now.
It's almost like I kind of know what I'm doing.
I kind of know.
You know what? Only on Thursdays and Fridays with Jacob and Colette.
Listen, they have signed a few blue liners, a pair of them. They signed defenseman Michael Beltrano and forward Samuel Lake out of the Great North Under 18 Hockey League, which was announced this past Monday, that the Soo Thunderbirds have inked two more players out of the Soo Junior Greyhounds program.
Two players.
See, I love that. I love how they foster, they bring them in, they show them the Soo, they foster all that talent, and they keep them here in the Soo.
Which is awesome.
Absolutely.
I think it helps with your development a lot, because like, you're getting to work with the same trainer, same coaching staff, and the same development team for a much longer time.
Yeah,
which
for
I think
sure.
is going to help with your development, like, long term.
Absolutely. And a shout out to Matt Stefano again for always updating me, Matt. I appreciate it. Keep it coming, buddy. And we will keep letting everybody know what's going on.
Yeah, we always appreciate the help, Matt.
Yeah,
so thank
sure.
you.
For shizzle, my dizzle.
I'd Snoop Dogg.
I know. Anyways, also we've got the former Thunderbirds defenseman Colin Miller winning gold.
That was awesome.
Well, let's talk about that game.
That was an awesome game. Let's talk about that entire tournament.
Let's talk about the entire tournament. That's a great idea, Joe.
You look at that, okay? So this is the first time in the World Hockey Championship history a team has gone 0-3 to then win the championship.
Yes.
It is also, you know, Heidi, I got my own factoids too. It's also the first time
Heidi.
A team has ever lost four games in a series.
Yeah.
And still won gold.
Yeah. It was awesome.
Which is unbelievable. Because I'll be honest, when Canada lost that first three, we were both kind of just like, what is going on?
We were still wearing black from the Toronto Maple Leafs, but you know.
And then they bring in a guy like Andrew Mangiapane, who won the tournament MVP with 11 points. Connor Brown was stellar as always. Man. Goaltending from Darcy Kemper started to play really well. Our defense started to really kick in with Soo's own Colin Miller, Thunderbirds alumni.
Yes.
Like, this team really found their game, and give it up to the coaching staff as well.
Woo, woo.
They did an awesome job at, you know, figuring out what wasn't, maybe the Leaf should have taken something out of their book. You don't continue to put out the same product when it's not working. Uh-huh. They saw what wasn't working. They changed up the lines.
Yes.
And all of a sudden they started winning. The only game they lost after going 0-3 was to Finland in overtime, which was just enough because they got that overtime to make it into the rounds to then beat Russia, the U.S., and then Finland again.
Yeah. Well, hey, talk about a product that you don't want to change when it's working. How about these two right here? We'll be right back after this quick break, and we're going to have Jacob have some more analysis of sports. And I'm not letting the fact go that I was right over a couple series in the first round. We'll be right back.
705 Sports, supported by Maker North, 3D printing, laser cutting, 3D design, education, prototyping, and more. Maker North, whatever it takes.
Well, welcome back to 705 Sports with Colette Linden and your favorite sports analyst, Jacob Moore, who has been breaking stories faster than TSN. A couple times now. No, you have.
You make me blush. No, it's been honestly, it's actually been incredible to, you know, I'm getting a lot more comfortable with doing this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And I do want to thank the overall support I have been getting from Soo Online, the team here, plus my Jacob Moore Sports Analyst Facebook page. If you're not following it, what are you doing?
What follow a plug. It. Holy cow.
I know
not,
how to plug.
I didn't mean you're a plug. I mean a plug. Okay, in this segment, folks, hang on to your knickers. We're going to talk about how I was right about two first round what are we going to call it? Two first round
picks.
Thank you very much. We're going to talk about the CFL, and I guess his Toronto Argonauts are somewhere in there too. We're going to talk about some NHL.
Exactly.
And that's about it.
So let's,
what else? What else we got?
Quickly get into the CFL because everyone knows I'm a big CFL supporter.
Yeah. Okay, let's go.
The CFL is trying to get their season off the ground, but it doesn't seem all nine teams want to be off the ground. We have the Toronto Argos and the Montreal Alouettes, who have been rumored to maybe not want to play this year. So I have reached out to both teams, and I haven't heard anything yet. But as soon as I hear something, I will make sure to bring you that information very quickly.
Okay.
I do wonder if it has to do with lack of fans, as neither province has approved. I know Hamilton says they're playing a Grey Cup, whether anyone plays it or not. That's what the owner of the Hamilton Tiger Cat said, so I know they're 100% in. But these two teams, we're not so sure. Will we see a seven-team season this year? I don't know. But obviously, my favorite saying is, not just eggs, stay locked on TV, and we will give you those updates when they become available.
All right.
Now, to get into what you were right about, and I was wrong. I will admit that.
Oh, my.
I am someone who will admit when I make a boo-boo. Goodness.
Yes.
The Tampa Bay Lightning have stormed through the first two rounds.
Yes, they have.
Get it stormed because they're Lightning.
Yes, I get that.
Did you get it?
Did you get it? And they brought the Lightning.
So I predicted they were both going to beat the Panthers and the Hurricanes. You predicted that the Hurricanes and the Panthers didn't stand a chance in HE double hockey stick.
Yeah.
And you were correct, especially the Hurricanes.
Stop. Say that again. I was. Okay, thank you. Still a whisper, still right.
But no, you are definitely right on that. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if the Tampa Bay Lightning is going to be able to take down the New York Islanders. I want to get into what the New York Islanders have done so far. Because I've also been right on that. A lot of people told me I was crazy when I said the Islanders.
Yeah, right on that. You just had to say that because I was right.
You know what? Two rights. Three rights, sorry. Make a left. Two rights. Take you home, maybe, depending on where you live. But the Islanders, what they have been doing to have success, they are a four-line team.
Okay.
They're deep in their center core. They play the same game no matter what the score is. And I give that up to Barry Trotz. Because we've had this conversation a lot where people say, oh, he's just the coach. 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 I have nothing else to throw. I don't need papers today. Trying to go green.
Yeah.
But not a green screen. These are real TVs. But what Barry Trotz does, he puts in a mentality of you play hard no matter what. You look at the Islanders roster. They shouldn't have beat Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
They shouldn't have beat Boston. That Boston series, Boston actually looked intimidated when they played very hard.
Yeah.
Especially Matt Martin, who the Leafs traded. And Leo Komarov, who the Leafs traded. just want to, you know.
Did they trade them?
Yes, they did.
I think they traded
them. That was during the whole, when that came out because of the whole Mitch Marner situation with Mike Babcock. That is a segment in itself.
Mitch Marner is going to have three segments on our next show, and it's going to be three strikes and you're out, I think is what we should call it.
I agree with that. Okay. But also, another thing the Islanders are doing very well is goaltending. And they have used, I don't know if you know this.
I don't.
This is the first time in NHL history a team has used two different goalies in the first two rounds to both get four wins. So Sorokin got all four wins in the first round against Pittsburgh.
Okay.
And Varlamov got all four wins in the second round against Boston.
Well, that's
so now
excellent.
we need a third string goalie to come in and get all four wins.
Can we just say it one more time though? Who won that series again? But did Boston win that series?
You know what? You know what? We're gonna go with a B for beaten.
How about those Boston Bruins?
You see, as I was explaining this to some of the other coworkers here in the building, as a Leaf fan, a good acknowledgement is when the Leafs go out early is when Boston goes out the next round. Doesn't matter if we play Boston. It's always like, okay, the world is somewhat in order because the Boston Bruins will not win the Stanley Cup, and that perfection line was perfectly out of scoring power. Because that perfection line was completely shut down for most of the game, especially that game six. Both of Boston's goals were on power plays. But to get into what the Lightning are going to do to try to stop the Islanders from that four lines of, I would say four lines of almost perfect hockey. Goaltending.
Okay.
Vasilevskiy is one of the, we talk about Carey Price. Vasilevskiy is like the younger Carey Price. This guy makes save after save after save, and he does it so calmly. Rod Brendamore, who is the coach of the Carolina Hurricanes, who they lost, even though I said they'd win. But you said they'd lose. So it's sports with one of us is right. So that's good enough.
It's the latter.
But as Rod Brendamore, that's a tough name to say, said, Vasilevskiy makes it look easy when he's in the net. He just is able to make these huge saves and kind of just goes like, kind of like Carey Price in that way. You notice Price very seldomly gets flustered. Vasilevskiy's the same way.
Because he's a true professional and in a true sport. Like, he's set such great sportsmanship. I love Carey Price, and he's so easy on the eyes.
He's no William Nylander.
Oh, my God.
Shout out to Dan, my brother, who is practically madly in love with William Nylander.
What? Dan?
As far as we don't have a shrine of...
This is the same guy who likes the pylon number three.
Dion Phaneuf.
Yeah, I don't need to say his name. Everybody just knows when you say pylon three who we're referring to. That's what?
Dion Phaneuf.
Oh, yeah. I can tell that. I took my earpiece out.
Dion,
I don't want to hear it.
Dion. Oh, you can't hear me.
No, I took it out.
Dion!
Oh, my God.
But let's get into what else Tampa's going to do. We got a little sidetrack. Yeah. Tampa, like the Islanders, they are a deep team that runs three to four lines every game, which is something you called when you said why Tampa was going to be able to beat the Panthers and the Hurricanes.
Yeah.
See, you are a sports analyst.
I
self-proclaimed sports analyst.
I know
analyst.
My sports. I mean, I know my sports. Also, to that end, we got to do some more golf. I had a lot.
We
of, I'm a huge golfer, and
well, as Leaf fans, we have to be golfers.
And boxing and MMA are also right up there too.
That is all Colette's jam.
Yes,
that is not mine. The only jam I like is rhubarb.
Oh, I love rhubarb.
So do I.
Rhubarb.
But another thing they will use is, if you notice, the Islanders are about grit. Well, the Lightning are about speed. They are not the drug. They are a very fast team.
The Lightning are both speed. Wow.
They are a extremely fast team with guys like, well, Kucherov is a great example, who is
so good.
Less than Mitch Marner on a salary cap. Yeah. Can you tell them a little? If you've read my article, you know I'm not a big Mitch Marner fan. My latest one, which I will be doing another one soon about what happened to the Winnipeg Jets.
I hate to beat a dead horse, but I'm going to. Like, where was Marner during the playoffs? I got it out. I had to say it.
There we go.
Oh my God, you were horrible. Absolutely horrible. I feel better.
See?
It's like couch time with
Therapy
Jacob
session.
Moore. Thank you, Jacob.
You know what?
But where was Marner during the playoffs?
You know what it, do you know what it was? I got it. He didn't have eggs.
Yeah.
But you know who does have eggs?
Yeah.
Victor Hedman,
okay.
Who we talked about, Tampa Bay, and I think this team lives and breathes not off Steven Stamkos, not off Kucherov, not off their depth. I think this team is a ride-or-die team with Victor Hedman.
Okay.
This guy is one of the best defensemen I have ever watched play the game. He is physical like Jake Muzzin, but can skate like Morgan Riley and can shoot like Shea Weber. It's like an unstoppable force.
Yeah.
He is one of the, when people talk about the best players in the league and they always go, oh, it's McDavid, who can't seem to win a playoff round either. I look at it and it's Victor Hedman. Victor Hedman is one of the best players I have ever seen play the game.
Well, that's quite the statement, mister.
And I just made it. For on TV, I'm Jacob Moore.
Egg drop. Instead of a mic drop, get it? Egg drop.
But that series, I do think the Islanders have a very good chance of taking down Tampa, just because in that series against the Florida Panthers, if you notice, Tampa did get a bit banged up, and the Islanders make the Panthers look small. So that's where it could come into play, but it's just going to depend. Vasilevsky could also steal a series. Hedman can steal everything. They're a very, very good team. That series will go 6 or 7.
Okay. Cool.
What are you thinking on that one?
I don't right now. I don't. I'm still, right now my heart is pounding because I was just thinking about Marner. And,
but,
and not in a, ooh, he's so dreamy.
But we already got to go. What a action-packed show. We didn't even get through everything, but you know what that means?
What?
It means you got to come back next week.
That's true.
Come back next week for 705 Sports with Jacob, Colette, the rest of the crew. Thanks, everyone. I don't probably shouldn't throw the laptop.
Here. Here you go. And
bye.
We out.